There is no power up there that can defeat us. We're invincible, invincible. And there's nothing on earth that can delay us. God's only hour is irresistible. Nothing can separate us from the one who died to save us. Come fill us, Holy Spirit. Send your word and let us hear it, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Let your spirit rain upon us. Please hear our cry and rain upon us. Lord, we declare we welcome you right now. Lord, assure us into your throne room where we can worship and adore you. We long to feel your presence every hour. Holy Spirit, rain down.
Rain down, Lord.
There is no power. There is no power.
Holy Spirit. this picture. Ask Holy Spirit what he wants to say. I was just looking at the picture, and I was getting the word that somebody has something. God has something he wants to download to you. And as we look at this picture, I was hearing rain down, and you see the fist around the hammer, and the Spirit of God coming down. I want you to just come. You can stand right here. Just look at the picture. And if you have a word from the Lord, we want to hear what he's saying to us right now through this time, through this song, and through this picture. So just as you feel led, just come on up.
Lord,
don't have to all combine, all right? So if you feel like you've got a word but it doesn't match what someone else brings, it's all right, bring it. But as I'm standing here looking at this, I feel like God's saying that the lightning of his power and authority, he has brought it down into some of our lives. And I speak from experience for this week, this last week. The power of transition moves us to a place where God is wanting to evolve in our own lives the things that he has already established. He has moved us, caused us to transition into the places that we're supposed to go. So sometimes we resist. We don't go, or we're not paying attention when he's telling us to move. And so sometimes he brings down a rod of lightning.
Amen.
That just
yes.
shakes your world and causes you to have to move. But he's moving you because he wants to transition you into the place that you're supposed to be for the next season. That's our word. It comes from experience. It comes from this picture. So anybody else? All right. Be listening tonight. Be listening for what the Holy Spirit is bringing. Feel free to come up and share.
Power.
Lord, I just want to thank you. I thank you that this is the month of revelation. This is the month of hearing from you. So we just, and your glory falling down. So each one of us, Lord, we just ask that you would reveal your heart and what you have in this next season for us, Lord. Pour out your glory in Jesus' name.
So turn to someone and say, there's a diamond inside of you.
Rising above the dust.
Okay, I'd like to kind of go off of what Gil was saying, but when I'm looking at the picture, the top right is really dark. Looks like to me that the castle, that gate is a stronghold, and the bottom is the light. You know, it's almost like a decision to break that lock, that stronghold. And obviously, it's the power of God, the King in His hand, which is going to make it happen. And what that means to me is, you know, this week I had a employee get all frustrated and bust out of my company, and they called OSHA. And so OSHA came in, and they're going to fine me and stuff like that. But what my wife said immediately was, we are going after larger companies that in order for them to give us work, we have to comply, and we have to raise to another level. And it's very hard. I have to spend a lot of money. I have to buy bigger tools. I have to hire the right people. And immediately, about 4 hours after OSHA came, spent about an hour with me. You know, I had a lot of fear, and they left. I finally got an email from Universal Creative with a project to look at. And I've been going after Universal for about 4 years. Well, in order to work with them, you have to comply to this level of how you operate your shop and the people. So that's what I'm feeling, and that's what I know, Missy and I know what that's doing in our life and our business, is that it is breaking a stronghold to go to another level. It's easy to say, oh, God wants us to be up here, but it's another thing to go up there and take that authority, to break that lock, to break the stronghold that's been over my family and our generations, and to walk through that gate.
That's a good word. So turn to someone and say, I'm choosing to break down the strongholds in my life.
Down the strongholds.
So Lord, we pray that you will break down those strongholds. We choose to have them broken down. So Lord, come. Come into our hearts and our lives. Break down the strongholds. We have not been willing. Lord, make us willing.
Break down
our
the
hearts.
Break down the strongholds. Break down the strongholds.
As the music is playing and the drums are going, and I'm seeing this as a new sound that the Lord is releasing to break down those walls. And those things that sit here to believe, and those things within the walled city that says you can't have these because they're within the walled city, God's sending out the sound. He's breaking down those walls and He's making those walls to be demolished so those things that are captive are going to be released. Thank you.
It's got the lightning. It's got the dark clouds, the darkness. So, Lord, we just thank you. We can see already that you're aligning the thoughts. You're aligning everything. We can see your Holy Spirit working here tonight. We thank you for what you're doing. We see that there is alignment to come with you so that you can break down the strongholds. And even though we have gone through lightning and thunder and storms, you have a brighter place for us on the other side. Even though it may not look like it at the moment, there is a brighter place on the other side. Each one of us are going through. Raise your hand if you're going through any type of transition right now. Okay, about half. Well, no, about three quarters at least. All right, well, Lord, we thank you for the transition. Michael and Janice, thank you guys for coming tonight. We know you had a big, big, busy day. We bless you. We bless you and bless you. Thank you. All right, let's just enter back into worship. If you have something you feel like God has put on your heart, you got something? Amen. Let's give it up to the Lord. Go ahead. Give a shout out.
Lord, we welcome you. Lord, we welcome you. Lord, we welcome you to break through. Lord, we welcome you. Lord, we welcome you. breakthrough of the Lord. We welcome the breakthrough of the Lord. We welcome the breakthrough of the Lord. We
welcome you, Lord,
the breakthrough of the Lord. We
welcome
the breakthrough of the Lord. We
welcome
the breakthrough of the Lord. We welcome the breakthrough of the Lord. The breakthrough of the Lord. In your presence, there is power. In your presence, there is power. Oh Lord, in your presence, there is power. In your presence, there is. Thank you.
journey. Because tonight, he is going to show you the strongholds that need to come down in your life. There are specific things that you have come up against over and over and over. And the enemy is one. But we need to remember that the scripture says that the gates of hell will not prevail against God's people.
Amen.
When I first learned that verse, what I was taught is that those gates would chase you around and they would try to beat you down. But as a Christian, you could prevail against them. Well, gates don't go anywhere, do they? Gates don't go anywhere. They are stuck in one place. But what they're doing is holding you out of the good things that God wants you to have. There are certain things that you are meant to conquer, that you are meant to come up against, and you are meant to fight those things. And you know, it doesn't matter how big of a gate it is, if you've got the keys, you can go right through. And what did Jesus give to his people? He gave us the keys to the kingdom. So there is no gate that can hold us back, because Jesus Christ has already given us the keys. So as this music's going, let Holy Spirit take you to show you how you're going to walk through those gates. And you're going to transition into the new season. And you're going to step up, and he's going to show you what you're going to pass into. And just look at the glorious fields, the open fields that he's going to give you. Wherever your foot lands, he's going to give it to you. Let the music take you there. heard the words of that song that just came from the Holy Spirit, just speak those words over your heart, over your life. That's God telling you to speak life over yourself. Don't speak darkness. God's will is life and light. Lord, fill us with your light. Fill us with your light so exhaustively that there is no room in our hearts and our minds and our bodies for darkness to hide away anywhere. Search it out, Lord. With your light right now, search out every nook and cranny of darkness and shed your light on it. Expose it. Get rid of it.
We speak the life of your word. We speak the life of your word. We speak the life of your word upon your children.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Father. Gotcha.
Because you you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To
you are. Yes,
love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Be so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call.
Come on up here and stand, because we have a gift for you. And as we know, you know, we refer to Father God as Father, but he also holds all the attributes of the female as well. So he's actually all. And if you have any doctrinal disputes with that, you can come talk to me later and we can explain it. But yes, God holds all the attributes of both male and female. So we've been singing this song about how wonderful our Father is, but he's also a mother and can mother people who need to be mothered. And Tanya, come on up here. You're over the age of 20, I think. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm 21. Okay. All right. Well, we just want to bless each and every one of you for representing the female side. By the way, you two need to be coming down here. You can hang those up for a minute. Just come on down. We just want to bless you and pray for you. And then I'd like the men to come and just share. If you have a word you want to share, you can. If you don't have anything to share, it's okay. But we just want to at least hold our hands out to every one of these women. And we want to bless you. And so, Father, I thank you for these women that are here tonight. Each one of them has, in one way or another, whether spiritually or physically, they have mothered somebody in their lives because they have been there for somebody. And that's what you do, God. You come and you're there for us when we need you. You're there for us when we think we don't need you. You're always there with us. But I just want to ask, Lord, that you would give a special blessing to each one of these women here tonight, that when they walk out of here, that they will just be at a new level of their womanhood, whatever that means, that they would just be blessed beyond measure. And we just thank you for every single one of them. In Jesus' name. Anybody else have the word they want to share? Frank? And then we have a gift here for you.
I just want to thank you guys for your guys' heart, because if it wasn't for you guys, we wouldn't be here. You are our mother still. I don't know about anybody else, but Karen is a mother I never had. I lost mine when I was 5 years old, so I have that attachment, you know, that abandonment thing, and I snatch onto her really hard, and I just want to thank you for allowing me to do that. I know it's tough sometimes, but I thank you for that, and I thank all of you, because when we are weak, you are strong, and that is so true. So I just thank you all.
Amen. Amen. All right, so Dina has a little gift for each of you. And we hope you like it, enjoy it, and maybe take somebody out and help mother them. All right, well, bless all of you. Thank you. Do we have one more song? No? As you all know, those of you who have come, that this is the celebration, First Fruits, for the month of IYAR. And our teacher, my wife, Adina, is going to share with us what this month is all about and what we can expect and look forward to in the new month ahead. So, Lord, I just want to thank you for my beautiful wife and the anointing and the gift that you've given to her. In Jesus' name, speak through her and let us hear what you want us to hear. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Well, it's good to be here, and I'm just imagining these seats all filled. But it's exciting to be in our new abode, and we're thankful for the presence of God that is here, and just able to rest in that. Are the PowerPoint slides up? Yes? Okay. Sorry, are we processing through this? So this is the month of IYAR, the Hebraic month, First Fruits. I think most of you have been here with us when we've gone through this, but just in case the concept of First Fruits is new to you, next slide, we want to look at cycles of blessing that God has for us. In the very beginning, God set down an order and a structure that would be a blessing to us. You know, it wasn't a random thing where, you know, we would sleep for 24 hours. That sounds actually good right now. And then we'd work for 48, and then we'd work for 12, and then we'd rest, or, you know, that type of thing. But it was in a specific order and a calendar that he put in the sky. In Genesis 1:14, then God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night. Let them be for signs and for seasons, for days and for years." And so we see this order of rest and work, of celebration. Day and night, the moon, sun and moon. Weekly Shabbat, counting off the seventh day, taking that time off to rest, reflect, enjoy God. And then the first of the month, or the new moon, and that's what we're looking at tonight. And then seasonal feasts and festivals that he established and ordained and meant to be for eternity. So we're looking today at the New Moon Festival. Next slide, there we go. First Fruits. It's a time to, biblically, it's a time to worship, to give, to hear God, and a time to feast, to have a party. Well, we already had our feast, but this is just that time to get away, to spend with God. And I love what we've done here today, because there's been a lot of time and a lot of reflection of receiving from the Lord, of hearing from him, and receiving the blessings that he wants to give us. Sometimes when we think about that, you know, second one, a little scary, a time to give, it's like, what do I have to give and all that? And yet, it's always more about what he gives us, is we cannot outgive God. And so the next slide, we're looking at receiving his blessings. And this is when we understand first fruits and the power of first fruits, of being in God's timing, there's incredible blessings that he releases. And so Proverbs 3, 9, and 10 says, honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. So your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. How many want that overflow? You want your barns to be filled? This is one of the keys here, is to enter into first fruits. And for a lot of people, they go, well, I don't understand, isn't tithing first fruits, and I do that, and you know, blah, blah, blah. And no, they're distinctly different. There were several types of offerings that God had established. And the first fruits was at the beginning of the month or at the beginning of the harvest, beginning of any new season, is you would give the first portion. And it's not specified. It's between you and God. It could be a small amount. It can be a larger amount. It doesn't matter. But it's the point of you're giving that first. And his promise is that he blesses the rest of it. This next verse from Romans 11:16. If the part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. And so it's this principle that when we give God the first, he blesses all the rest of the month. And then at the end of the month, we calculate that. We take 10% of that, and that's our tithe. And so that's kind of the difference between a first fruit offering and tithe. Does that make sense? And so when we enter into that first fruits offering, there's a blessing that God wants to give us. And again, it's not a specific amount. It's between you and the Lord, what that looks like. So another part of this is not only staying in that place of blessing and receiving from him as we give, but also staying in his timing. So we have an enemy who does not want us to be in the right timing. Daniel 7:25, talking about the enemy, he shall speak pompous words against the Most High, persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. Now, earlier today, we were headed to Angel Platters for a nice Mother's Day lunch. And we had, you know, since we're in this apartment, it's a little crazy because we have four cars and only one parking spot assigned because of our kids. Our kids have cars. And so Gil was complaining about how far away we had to go to walk to get his car. It was like, you know, we have to walk 10, 15 minutes just to get to the car. And so we were joking about this. We get in the car and we're headed to Angel Platters. And then bam, right in front of us, there was a really, really bad car accident. And, you know, we pulled off. Gil went and helped the gentleman as much as he could in that time until medical help got there. But we were reflecting on it, that if the car had been parked closer, we potentially could have been right there in the path when this car hit a pole and spun out into the rest of traffic and hit another car. And so you have an enemy that hit, one of his biggest things is to get you out of God's timing so you get messed up. And plenty of us have been there, right? I have. But first fruits is part of that, learning how to get into the flow of God's timing so that the enemy is not getting us distracted and out of the path that God has for us. And so this is really key this month, because this month of IYAR is associated with the tribe of Issachar. Next slide. And so we're going to look at the tribe of Issachar. There's a couple of verses. The prophetic word that Jacob had over Issachar was Issachar is a strong donkey lying down between the saddlebags. And you go, what? But this is interesting because Issachar is represented as a strong donkey. That's a work animal. They work hard. They carry heavy burdens. But he knows how to rest. He knows how to enter into God's timing, when to work and when to rest. And then we see the prophetic word that Moses gave over Issachar is tied in with Zebulun, and we're going to look at that a little bit more later. But Deuteronomy 33, it says, rejoice, Zebulun, in your going out, and Issachar, in your tents. Now, when you first look at this, you go, now this doesn't make sense, because Zebulun's going out and working, and Issachar is staying in the tent. What is that about? You know, we just prophesied about him being a strong worker. But this is really key in these two tribes, and we're going to look at this in just a moment, how these two tribes work together. But Issachar knows what they're to do and when. Next verse, 1 Chronicles 12:32, of the sons of Issachar who had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. How many of you would love to be part of that tribe of Issachar? Okay? Because there's many times when I don't know the right timing of some things, and I don't always know what to do. But this was the gifting of the Issachar tribe, as they were a prophetic tribe. And so in the next slide, I believe, we see this connection between the first three tribes. Last month, we looked at the tribe, or Nisan, which is represented by Judah, worship and war. We've talked about Judah goes first. These are the three tribes that always move together at the front of the battle. And so you have worship and war, and then you have Issachar, which is the prophetic wisdom, understanding the secrets and mysteries of God. And then Zebulun is the wealth tribe. And if you think about the sequence of this, as we praise and worship and war in the Spirit, it begins to open that door of revelation for understanding the times and seasons, which then as we walk in God's timing, the wealth that is stored up for the righteous is released into kingdom purposes. And I want us to understand this a whole lot more, but these tribes were meant to go together, to flow together, and to be the blessing that God called them to be. So next slide, let's look a little bit more at IYAR. IYAR is a time to blossom. IYAR means blossom. It's a Babylonian name. It was called this after the exile. Before the exile, it was called Ziv. So that's my extent of pronunciation. But it means light or glow. And so turn to your neighbor and say, it's time for you to blossom. It's time for you to be radiant, to shine. This is a month for us to, in that place of receiving revelation from God, is to be shining bright for him. And as my husband already mentioned, it's a transition month. In the month of Nisan, we experience Pentecost, redemption, the blood of the Lamb, celebrating who Jesus is. We entered into first fruits as Jesus, the first fruits of those from the dead. And then we have this month of transition before next month we get to enter into Pentecost. Now, transition is always a challenging time. Let's go to the next slide. IYAR also, the letter that Hebrew letter that represents IYAR is Vav. Okay, we've already talked a little bit about Vav. How many know what Vav means? Or do you all think we're going crazy? Okay, Vav is a Hebrew letter that looks like a stake or a tent peg. And this is a time when we put that stake in the ground. And it's also a connecting pin between our past and our future. And so the month of IYAR is that connecting between understanding Passover, redemption, and moving into revelation. Okay? Now, how do do we handle transition? Next slide. Transition is a really fragile time. And if we don't steward transition well, the enemy can come in and really mess things up. Now, I'm always thankful that when we get in a mess, God has a way of escape through. But we want to understand how to transition well in this transition month, because it determines how we enter into the rest of the year. Does that make sense? So turn to your neighbor and say, I want to handle transition well this month. All right, next slide. Now this month of IYAR, when we look at the history of Israel, they would have just celebrated Passover and freedom from Egypt, and now they're transitioning out of Egypt to Sinai. And so the first place they came to were the bitter waters at Marah. Now God has just done all of these wonderful miracles for them, but they're starting to run out of water. And then all of a sudden, in the distance, they see it, water. And they go running over there. They're so excited. They scoop up. It's bitter. They cannot drink it. And that place of disappointment, because they saw what they needed and what they wanted and what they desired, it was right there. And then it was unusable. And so they begin to complain. They begin to complain to the Lord. But remember that this is a month of revealing the secrets of God, the mysteries of God and who he is. And so God set them up because he wanted to reveal who he was to them as a covenant God. And so he sets up this situation where they're disappointed, where they're frustrated. And he reveals himself as Yahweh Rapha, the Lord who heals. And so they throw wood, a branch, into the water, and it's miraculously healed. And so he comes as the healer. So this is a month when God wants to reveal himself to you as the healer. In fact, the Hebrew word IYAR is an acrostic for I am the Lord, your healer. And so it's a beautiful place of revealing this month who he is as your healer. Now, the next place they go is another test. And this is, next slide, they get to Elim. And now it's the perfect place. There's 12 springs. There's plenty of water. There's everything that they need. And they're comfortable. And it's a great place to just kind of hang out. And so they're just enjoying that. God is revealing himself to them as the Lord Rohi, the Lord my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. But how would they respond when they received blessings? Well, honestly, there was no thankfulness, no praise. They just kind of took it for granted and didn't enter into celebration and thanksgiving to God for what he had done. If you're in a season of blessing, are you remembering to be thankful for every gift that he's given to us? When we stop and think about everything that he's given to us, it's amazing. Life, breath, roof over our head. We almost had the roof over our head completely taken away to help us appreciate having a roof over our head. Sometimes it's these simple things that we don't always give God thanks for. And then he tells them to get moving again. And they really don't want to leave that nice spot of comfort. But they're in transition, right? So the next place they go is Rephidim. And here, there is no water. Now, by this time, they've gotten quite a ways out into the desert. and there's no palm trees off in the distance to give them some hope. All that they see everywhere is just this barren wilderness of rocks and dirt. And so they, again, get into this place of complaining to God, crying out to Moses, give us water to drink. They did not see any way of redemption. Now, sometimes we have all been in that place where it looks very bleak, where it looks impossible. You know, it's easier to have faith when we can see kind of a little glimpse of how God might provide for us. But when there is nothing, but that's the time he wants us to step into faith even deeper and to praise and worship him. But too often we're like the Israelites and we get stuck in hopelessness and self-pity. But God was faithful in revealing himself, water from the rock, Yahweh Jireh, the Lord who sees your need and provides. Today, whatever you're going through in the most difficult situations, God sees and he will provide for you. Now, there were some other things that happened at Rephidim. They begin to be attacked by the Amalekites. You probably remember the story is the Joshua was down with the warriors fighting against the Amalekites. Moses went up on the mountain in intercession. And as long as he kept his hands raised up, they had victory. But as soon as he got tired and put his hands down, they begin to experience defeat. And this is that place of intercession. And even in the place of intercession, we were never meant to intercede alone. We need one another to hold each other's arms up. And this is the place where God reveals himself as Yahweh Nisi, the Lord, my banner. And so as we see this transition time that the Israelites were going through, most of the time they didn't pass the test. Most of the time they battled with grumbling and complaining. But God was still faithful in the midst of it to reveal himself to them in new and amazing ways. Think about the transition that you're going through right now. What is God speaking to you? What name of God is he speaking into you? And how is he wanting you to respond? This is a time through the transition that we choose to walk in thankfulness, that we choose to count our blessings. So we're going to look at another passage of scripture that talks about this season between Passover and Pentecost. Next slide. And it's called Counting the Omer. How many have heard of Counting the Omer? Probably not too many of you. Okay, this is kind of an obscure verse in Leviticus. It says, you shall count from the eve of the second day of Pesach, or Passover, when an omer of grain is to be brought as an offering, 7 complete weeks. The day after the 7th week of your counting will make 50 days, and you shall present a new meal offering to God. So this is that time between Passover and it's called the Feast of Weeks in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, we call it Pentecost. Penti means 50 days. And so sometimes we just think Pentecost is the Holy Spirit coming, but actually it was established back in the Old Testament. And what it signified originally was the giving of the law at Sinai. And we'll be talking about that next month in more detail. But it is this transition time, is God gave something specific for us to do each day. And counting the Omer was about counting your blessings. So go to the next slide. Daily coming before the Lord and recounting what he has done for you. That helps to safeguard us from that complaining, that grumbling through the transition. But no matter what we see in the natural or what we're going through in the midst of that transition, we choose to say, God, I praise you because. And it was a foretaste of the harvest to come. So at First Fruits, which was right after Passover, they had a feast that was called First Fruits. And that was when Jesus rose from the dead. But the priests would wave their barley before the Lord and give it as an offering. And then they would do that daily for those 50 days. I'll go back to the slide, last slide, please. They would do that daily to remember what God had done for them, to be in preparation in that transition time from Passover to Pentecost. And then it was also the first census to take place where the tribes were aligned around the tabernacle. And so there was an order that was established during that time. Now, it's interesting to me about taking a census, because if you remember the story when David took a census, it was a big, bad problem, right? But this case, Moses was instructed to count the people and to line them up by their tribes. And so there's a time to set that order and to count. And there's other times when God says, don't count. You know, sometimes we look at scripture and we go, oh, well, counting is in style. We're going to count, you know. We're going to count how many people are here. We're going to do this and figure out this. And God's like, you know, I'm not really into numbers, but there is a place of order, alignment, and stewardship. And so this is all the things that happened during that transition time. Go to the next slide. Now, in the New Testament, during the month of Iyar, this would have been between Jesus' resurrection and his ascension. Again, a time of transition. And in a lot of ways, when you think about the trauma that the disciples had gone through, where, you know, the one who they put all their hope in is crucified, and all their hopes dashed, and then he rises again. Can you imagine just the stuff that they would have to process through that? And so this was a time of transition for them as well. This was a time when the Great Commission was given. It was a time of kingdom building. Some people believe this was a time when God or Jesus was sharing with them about fivefold ministry and how to build his kingdom. We don't know. I really wish there was more details about that time. You know, I'd love to have a transcript of those times when Jesus met with the disciples or met with different groups of people. But we don't have all of that. We know that the Spirit can download what we need in that time. And so that is a time of transition that we see with Jesus as well. And so to kind of summarize the next slide, the month of Iyar is a time to enter in, to listen for God's wisdom and direction, to continue to praise, because remember last month was about Judah going first and about praise and worship. So when we go to a next month, we don't just stop doing what we did last month. Is each month builds on one another. We start with praise and worship and warfare. And through that into the next second month, this month, we enter into that time of hearing God's voice as we have warred for that portal to be open between heaven and earth, to hear in new ways what God has for us. And so we count our blessings instead of complaining. We transition from redemption to revelation. We come into alignment. We take some time to think about our alignments. How are we moving with one another? Are we aligned correctly in our work, in our ministry, in our family? Are there tweaks that we need to make to come into that alignment? Where we see God's provision and we receive his commission for this season. And it's a time to blossom, to be radiant, and to glow. So turn to your neighbor and say, you're glowing. All right. So we're going to enter back into worship. I don't know where we lost our worship team. Here they come. We're going to enter back into worship. And as usual, the offering box is here for you to give your first fruit offering. And this is our gift to you this month. Take a sheaf or two of grain. Take it home with you. And all this month, every time you see it, Remember to count your blessings. God has so much for you. Be thankful.
You know, I was looking at this, honey, and just realizing how it matches your hair. So if we were to go dancing, I could kind of just swing you around and say, I'm waving my blessing.
I just wanted to talk about something that I saw today, and it sort of rang when you were saying wait for God's wisdom. And I was riding my mountain bike out at Folsom Lake and went up to Doten's Point, and I'm sitting up there and watching the lake, and the lake is so full now. It's only 15 feet from the top. And just 5 months ago, the government, they were saying it's going to be years till it fills up again. Global warming, gloom, doom. And it was like, statisticians are really wrong. Their models are really wrong. Man is really wrong about this, because God just came in and filled that lake up and just showed us that don't listen to man. God's government is above man's government. And so listen to him. And then right after that, a bald eagle flies by about 50 yards away, must have had a 7-foot wingspan. He was just gigantic. And he came flying by, and it was like, wisdom. Wisdom, what wisdom do you look for? Which wisdom do you listen to? So it was just God saying, don't listen to man and government's wisdom. Listen to him, what he has to say, because he's the truth. He has no motive except to love upon you and guide you and keep you well. So it was just a beautiful sight, just a beautiful sight to hear and see.
Amen. Well, Father, we thank you for the blessings that you shower upon us. We pray for more insight, wisdom, and ability to see deeper into your spirit the blessings, so that we can be thankful, so that we can praise you and worship you in everything that you're blessing us with, Lord. Sweet tonight, just want to bless you because of the things that you have given to us here tonight. Even this place is a blessing. Can we say, give out a hallelujah for the transition into this place? Say hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Thank you. So come on up, grab one of these, whether you have an offering or not, come up and grab one of these, all right?
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. From every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. You are good. Lord, you are, Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. you are, yes, you are, yes, you are. You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, and all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, and all the time. You are good, Lord, you are good, and your mercy endure it forever. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endure it forever. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endure it forever. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endure it forever. Lord, you are. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endure it forever. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endure it forever.
All right, so we're going to do communion now. The way this is going to work, Joan and Beth are going to come up here, and they're going to pray over the elements. And you're going to go ahead and come on up and just dip the bread into the juice. And you're going to go ahead and take that on your own. I encourage you to stay on the wood floor here so it doesn't drip. All right, Beth and Joan.
I just want to pray from Psalm 16 this morning. It's morning, actually, evening. Whatever time it is. It's God's time. So, Lord, we just want to thank you that you are our prize. You are our pleasure. You are our portion. You are our inheritance. God, you are Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. You are our provider. For your whispers in the night give us wisdom, showing us what to do next. We thank you because you are close to us and always available, always approachable. We are never shaken, for we experience your wraparound presence every moment. Our heart and soul explode with joy, full of glory. For you bring us a continual revelation of resurrection life. Thank you for your resurrection life, the path that brings us to the overflowing joys of the exquisite and eternal pleasures of gazing upon you. We give you all the glory and all the praise, for you are with us always. We love you and we praise you. We thank you for this time in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you want to come forward.
And again, I just encourage you to keep over the wood floor.
Open my eyes and let me see. You lead and lead this heart adore. Open my eyes.
Our hands and we praise you. We honor you and we respect you because you are the sovereign God, the creator of all things, the redeemer of all things. We thank you for the gifts that you have given us here tonight and the blessings. And I just want to say that earlier when I said close your eyes and just picture where God wants to take you, what gate he's wanting you to open. And the picture I got was a picture of me standing at a gate, and it was dark everywhere. And Jesus came over, and I had these keys, but I couldn't get them to work. And he said, "Do you really want to go in that gate?" And he went ahead and he unlocked it for me. And we both kind of pushed on it. It was really rusty and old and covered with garbage, and he goes, "Do you really want to go in this gate?" I said, "No." He said, let me show you the gates I have for you. And he took me on up the road, and it just got lighter and lighter and brighter and brighter. And then it just opened up, and there weren't any gates. It was as if I'm fighting to open up the wrong gate. I'm standing at the wrong gate. And he's already opened things up, and he said, go. So, Lord, I just thank you for the gifts that you've already given us. We receive them, Lord. We receive them fully and completely. Help us where we have not. Help us where we have not fully received them to understand the gifts that you have given us. And may we this week, Lord, unlock the things that you want us to unlock, to simply move into the areas that are already unlocked, and to take the territory that you have given to us in Jesus' name.